How high will petrol prices go because of the attacks in Saudi Arabia? The world's biggest oil exporter is scrambling to repair the damage, and Houthi fighters in Yemen are vowing more attacks. Will the threat force a rethink of our thirst for Saudi oil? This is Inside Story. Hello and welcome to the program. I'm Hashem Ahelbarra. Saudi Arabia is trying to reassure the world that it will quickly recover from Saturday's attacks on its oil plants. But the reassurance failed to stop oil prices soaring 19%, the highest ever increase in 30 years. Prices have since eased, but concerns remain about the 50% cut for the world's biggest crude exporter, especially because Houthi fighters in Yemen are vowing more attacks to cripple Saudi's economy. U.S. satellite photos of the damage have been released, and Donald Trump warned that the U.S. is locked and loaded to respond and ready to release emergency oil reserves if needed, while Iran rejects U.S. accusation that it's involved. Let's have a look at who has the biggest reserves of oil. All member states of the International Energy Agency have 90 days of emergency stockpiles in case of crisis. The US holds the world's largest strategic petroleum reserve, followed by China, Japan and South Korea. Almost 80% of the world's proven oil reserves are in OPEC member countries. Saudi Arabia, Venezuela and Iran top that list. Now over to our panel in Amman, Jawad. Anani, Jordan's former deputy prime minister as well as foreign minister. He's also an economist. In Bern, Switzerland, Cornelia Meyer, an economist as well as an oil and gas specialist at the financial advisory firm Meyer Resources. In London, Bill Law, journalist and analyst on Gulf Affairs. Welcome to you all. Mr. Anani, the increase in oil prices, which was about 19%, was perhaps the biggest percentage spike in three decades. Is this an indication of a panic or a deeper economic crisis here?
Well, I think that it is mostly panic, because there was no reason for oil prices under normal circumstances to have increased that fast in one day. So it was a complete response to the bombing of the facilities, oil facilities in East Saudi Arabia, despite all the ideas and the pronouncements of President Trump and as well as the Minister of Secretary of Energy in the States to calm the market, and also Saudi Arabia's declaration that they want to use their reserves, but people still panic because they don't know how much time it would take the Saudis to repair those facilities, and how much, and what would happen to the actual usage of reserves, mm-hmm. if not strategic reserves. So in a way, there is a complete absence of specific information, which mm-hmm. worries speculators.
Cornelia, so is it mostly because of the absence of further information from the Saudi government, as Mr. Anani was saying, about the scope of the damage, whether Saudi Arabia will be able to get its act together, resume output anytime soon, that is creating the panic that we're seeing across global markets?
I think it's two things. It's, first of all, markets always overshoot. They always overshoot and they undershoot. And people didn't do the numbers. When you look at how many reserves we have, and also how many reserves Saudi Aramco have. Saudi Aramco can between 30 and 45 days of Saudi production. They have reserves across the globe. So people weren't really doing the numbers. And I think now what will be really important is how fast can Aramco get the upcake processing plant back up. And let's be clear, oil processing plants are not like light switches. It will take time to get it up. So we have information need. And then we need to differentiate. There is the current shortfall because of the attacks. And then there is also suddenly analysts realized, oh, there is a risk premium, a geopolitical risk premium. That had been all but gone. So in that sense, we have to see how that will pan out. But in the end, oil markets still, you know, up until Saturday, everybody said, oh, we are so oversupplied. And once the uptake plant is up and running again, we're still basically oversupplied.
Bill, reconsidering the risk premium for future deals, is this something that is just related to this particular incident, or do you think it's something which is going to be definitely taken into account for a longer term?
I think that the risk factor is not simply related to this particular incident, as severe as it is. The risk factor will build in the fact that the Saudis have shown themselves incapable of protecting their most crucial and valuable asset. And after all, this attack hit the heart of Saudi Aramco. It was a pinpoint attack. It was very destructive. We don't know how long it's going to take to get the facility up to speed again. And as your other commentators have noted, that is a huge question, because the longer it takes, the more damaging it will be to the Saudis, and most particularly to the Saudi economy. So there's a lot of reason for people to be concerned. And I would think that the appetite, for example, for the Aramco IPO will be waning somewhat, certainly on the international front, because of this attack.
Jawad, the Houthis said that they flew 10 drones to launch this daring attack at the heart of Saudi Arabia. Do you think that this is something that could potentially change the dynamics that have shaped global energy markets?
Well, until we come to grips with the fact that the Houthis, it was the Houthis who did it, probably they may have technically and logistically helped by other forces or outside forces like Iran. But still, that means that we are, you know, we have turned the page, and this is a new phase in the war. So in a way, the question remains, as far as future tensions are concerned, whether the Saudis and their allies would retaliate in order to restore the what we call might call deterrence balance, or they might, if they don't do that, then they feel that their negotiating position has been weakened. So in a way, while they are worried about a further retaliation by the Houthis aiming at their oil facilities, which would aggravate the situation in Saudi Arabia, I think that because of the surgical precision at which the first, the last one, the Friday morning raid was carried, I think that now we have new dimensions to contend with. And I believe that the Saudis will retaliate eventually, and that may invite further retaliations or counter-retaliations from the Houthis. And if that continues without an interference in trying to bring the all parties to the table to sit down and discuss, then we may be in for a big and a long retracted war that only God knows how it will end.
Cornelia, it seems that the Saudis have been concentrating their processing plants in one particular area. And this explains why, after the attack, almost a half of their output has been severed. Do you think this is something that will take the Saudis really weeks and weeks in the future to be able to contain?
Well, look, the thing is, It is in one part, because the largest oil field, you know, it's in the eastern province where the oil is. So obviously the biggest processing plant is where the oil is. So in that sense, but I think responding to the former prime minister, I totally agree with him. And one of the things we need to look at is also what lessons has the Saudi defense apparatus learned? Because clearly Saudi is the third largest procurer of weaponry, of arms. So in that sense, you know, they just they will need to prove that they will really look at their that they can. It's not that they're not just going after airplanes, but also after drones. So they will need to prove that they have the equipment. They will have to prove that they know very well how to use that equipment.
Bill, when you look at this particular case, which is the attack targeting the oil fields in Saudi Arabia, I think it exposes or underscores in a way or another the vulnerability of the oil production facilities in the Middle East. Is this something that should be taken into consideration by key players in the future?
Oh, yes, I think so. It hugely underscores the vulnerability. And you'll recall that the Houthis had previously hit the oil pipelines, doing really minor damage. This particular hit, as I said, striking at the heart of Saudi Aramco, will send shockwaves, I think, throughout the Middle East, but most particularly in Saudi Arabia, because after all, it's not just the infrastructure of Saudi Aramco that is potentially vulnerable. It is also desalination plants. It could potentially be civilian targets. Really, this new technology that either the Houthis or those who are assisting the Houthis, there are suggestions these attacks may have come from Iraq, from the Hashdashabi, the Shia militias, in retaliation for an Israeli attack in August, that this kind of situation can rapidly escalate. And I think, as the former prime minister said, it could lead to something that could be potentially a war of enormous and really quite horrible consequences.
Jawad, we're seeing now analysts talking about, and governments also raising the issue of tapping into strategic stockpiles to be able to mitigate the risks and also stop any further spike in oil prices. Is this...
Well, I agree. Yes, go ahead.
Is this because of the confusion which has been spreading all over the world about what's happening in Saudi Arabia?
Yeah, I think, you know, at the beginning, I agree with Carol, with Cornelia, that at the beginning, you know, there was completely people were oblivious to the detailed information. First of all, you know, Saudi Arabia itself is a large consumer of its oil production. Saudi Arabia right now is producing 10 million barrels, roughly, of which 4 million they use at home. So in a way, their capacity to export is about 6 million barrels a day. If they lose 5.7, that means that does not leave them with much oil to export. So in a way, the Saudis need to do something that will impact their budget and also impact their GDP growth and their diversification program. On the other hand, I think that if they opt for retaliation in order to teach the Houthis not to repeat the same experience without severe consequences, then they have to hit back, and mostly there will be many civilian casualties. Mm-hmm. Such casualties will cause a great deal of panic. But the world, like Caroline said, Cornelia said, has about 4.1 billion barrels of reserves. These are the statistics from the International Energy Agency, IEA. And accordingly, and the United States has 727 million barrels which are for the government. Mm-hmm. In Saudi Arabia, the reserves are they range between 180 million to 200 million. Those are distributed all over the world. But also large consumer countries have their own also mm-hmm. reserves. But they don't like to see their oil reserves drop to critical limits. So they may use probably 40% or 50% of them. But then if they think that this war is going to drag, they will have to start buying. And okay. We need new sources of supply. And we cannot rely on reserves alone.
So, Cornelia, for this particular reason, why are we suddenly, particularly over the last 24 hours, seeing all this talk about the need to tap into emergency oil inventories to maintain stability?
Well, I think part of it is, you know, Donald Trump is not a detail man, right? So he probably didn't do quite the numbers before that, before he made his point. And it is part of, you know, we want to calm the markets. People want to calm the markets because you saw at the beginning of the day, it was 20% up the oil price. Now it's about between 8 and 9% up. So it came down considerably. So this is mainly to calm the markets and to say, look, there is enough oil there. But as both gentlemen said, it's really the issue is where from here. And this is not just Saudi Arabia. It is also the UAE. You know, the UAE is also in that coalition against the Houthis. And the UAE, you know, they have also oil processing plants. So the whole region, the GCC has always been that island of stability in that sea of unrest and strife that is the Middle East. So this brings the GCC and especially Saudi Arabia one step closer to the ramifications of that strife, and it will be very important, I think, for everybody that cooler heads prevail, because if we have too much tit for tat, then it can really get out of control.
Bill, if you look at the map of the region, you have two hotspots here. You have war in Yemen, and then we saw the aftermath of that war, basically the attacks targeting oil facilities in Saudi Arabia. But at the same time, you have the showdown between the Iranians and the American over the Strait of Hormuz. Potentially, we're talking about what could potentially become a huge crisis in the world if suddenly you have a disruption in the Strait of Hormuz and then you have a disruption in Saudi Arabia.
Yes, and we shouldn't forget also that Iraq, the war in Iraq against ISIS, Daesh, is not over. And in fact, that remains a threat. Iraq is still in a very fragile situation. And you're right. I mean, there are a couple of things that could go simply wrong that could lead to a major confrontation. That's the concern, and it is important that everyone step back and calm down. I mean, it's interesting. Donald Trump has taken a lot of flack from American commentators because of the tweet in which he said, I'm waiting to hear from the Saudis before I decide what to do. As some wags have said, why is the Saudi crown prince dictating American foreign policy and whether or not we go to war? But the fact is that I have to say that probably is a sensible thing to say, because the last thing that we need now is any further escalation. Now, the Iranians are playing a very clever game here. They're pushing and pushing. Will they have the sense to draw back? I think they will. But if the Americans, for example, did hit Iran, that would take this thing into a whole new orbit and a very dangerous orbit. So I think we do need to have this this pause. And the fact is that oil prices did drop quite dramatically, as Cornelia said, that they started at 20%, they're now down below 10%. So there is that calming factor at play.
Jawad, what does this crisis mean for big importers, China, India, Japan, and other countries?
Well, you know, it means that they probably would like to diversify their sources of oil in the future. And secondly, I think it may invite also other issues like using pipelines instead of shipping, because shipping, in case the war escalates and continues, gets protracted. I think the marine shipment of oil might be the first victim of such a development. So therefore, the cost of insurance, the cost of transportation of oil will become an important factor in determining how far prices could go. So in a way, I look at the future and I say that probably they may look for other sources, and they may also resort to constructing long pipelines. The second issue is that, you know, vulnerability of China and India in particular, because each imports about 10 million barrels of oil every day, and they constitute about 20% of total world demand. So in a way, that is a very important thing for them
to take into account.
And any interruption of oil would mean that their economic growth will be even even squeezed further. So I believe that, here, if Saudi Arabia must be extremely careful about maintaining the same supplies, honoring the same contracts with both countries, Japan and South Korea as well, in order to guarantee that those clients would not seek other alternatives and would continue to deal with Saudi Arabia.
Cornelia, we've been talking about the geopolitical implications or implications of the crisis, but then let's talk a little bit about the impact of this crisis at average people all over the world, because usually spiking oil prices are more about people having to pay more at gas pumps, decline in spending and decline in economic growth. Is this something that is going to take some time, or is just going to be a shorter term impact of the crisis that we've seen?
Well, it's a shorter-term impact of the crisis. And what I always notice is that whenever the oil price goes up, it's immediately passed through to the consumer. However, when it goes down, it's not that immediately passed through to the consumer, which is how, if you're an international oil company, you make your money or part of your money. But the thing to really be clear here, yes, it will pass through, and we will have to see where we go. But let's not forget the backdrop. Up until Friday night last week, we were all worried about oversupply and ever falling oil prices. Sure. OPEC and its 10 allied nations, OPEC Plus, took 1.2 million barrels out of the system. We thought we needed to, in December when they meet again, take out another million barrels or 500,000 barrels. So in that sense, let's look against the backdrop. Yes, there is a spike. It has come down. But we really need to look a little bit, how quickly this facility comes up again, how Saudi Arabia is able to assuage the analysts and the global markets. Yeah. And let's give it 2 weeks to see really how much the consumer is going to be hit at the pump.
Okay. Bill, Saudi Arabia has been using Aramco for almost 60 or 70 years for its political and financial leverage worldwide. Now people are saying that this may no longer be the case, because even if they go for the initial offering, public offering for Aramco, there's absolutely no way they're going to get any closer to $1.4 trillion they were hoping to achieve. Does Saudi Arabia have to redefine its strategy in the near future, given the strings of attacks it has faced over the last few months?
Well, I think this is represents a huge setback for Mohammed bin Salman, the crown prince. As you say, he wanted to do this IPO, this sale of shares of Saudi Aramco. He initially had announced it was going to happen in 2019. It was postponed. Why? Because buyers were saying, well, if you're going to sell, you've got to be transparent. You've got to tell us, open up the books and show us where the money's going. Well, of course, it's something the royal family, the ruling family, the House of Saud, does not want to do, because a big chunk of that money goes directly into their pockets, and there are many, many pockets to be lined. The Saudis have reshuffled. For example, they replaced the energy minister, a highly respected minister, and have put in a brother, a half brother of Mohammed bin Salman, to run the the stripped down situation in Aramco. They put someone else in charge as a chairman of Aramco. So big shifts going on just at the point that this attack hits. And as I said, investors are looking at this and thinking, well, you know, is this really a safe bet? Because there is a huge risk factor here. And who's to say that the Saudis showing themselves really incapable of preventing such a terrifically powerful attack, who's to say another one couldn't happen again? So we have lots of questions that Mohammed bin Salman is facing. He needs this money from the IPO. I don't think he's going to get it. And as I say, the longer this thing stretches out, the more damaging it is to him, the more damaging to the Saudi economy, he's able to fulfill some of his dreams of altering the way in which that economy functions.
Unfortunately, we have to leave it there because we're running out of
may
time.
May I just say one thing, please?
Very briefly, if you don't mind, Cornelia.
May I just say one thing, please? Very briefly, the new oil minister, Prince Abdulaziz, he may be a half-brother, but he has for the last 30 years been a fixture in the oil ministry and in Aramco. He's one of the most highly respected people in OPEC. So he didn't just put Khalid Al-Faleh aside and took some nobody in there. That guy really is, he is, to a large part, Mr. Oil in Saudi Arabia.
But there's absolutely no doubt that they were talking about extraordinary times, delicate choices facing the Saudi government in the near future. Cornelia Meyer, Jawad, Anani below. Thank you very much indeed for your contribution to the program. And thank you too for watching. You can see the program again anytime by visiting our website, aljazeera.com. For further discussion, go to our Facebook page. That's facebook.com/AJInsideStory. You can also join the conversation on Twitter. Our handle is @AJInsideStory. From me, Hashem Ahelbarra, and the whole team here. Bye for now.